Welcome to the Everyday Journal Club. I'm Hope, a biologist with 15 years of research experience, now fortunate to be working in a Nobel Prize-winning lab. This channel has three main goals. One, to help you stay effortlessly updated on the latest scientific breakthroughs. No paywalls, no jargon overload. Two, to build a supportive community where we can exchange the most valuable experience-based research advice. Three, to share valuable strategies and concrete examples on how to achieve meaningful scientific breakthroughs. Once we reach 1,000 subscribers, I'll begin releasing content focused on the third goal. Let's go! Let's make great science together.
Imagine a future where we can actually engineer a whole human organ from scratch, a self-renewing one, giving our immune cells the training they need.
Yeah, or picture this. Finding a hidden dimmer switch inside our cells, one that controls the energy factories based on stress.
Exactly. A discovery that, you know, could totally change how we look at cancer treatment.
Right.
Today, we're diving into two, frankly, amazing papers that show these huge leaps in biology, really pushing what we thought was even possible. Welcome to the Deep Dive. We unpack these complex scientific breakthroughs, pull out the key bits, and basically give you a shortcut to getting up to speed. And today, it's two big studies from Nature, one in regenerative medicine, the other in really fundamental cell biology.
And our job here is to help you get not just what they found, but really why it matters. You know, aiming for those aha moments, but without drowning you in data.
Okay, so first up, rebuilding a working thymus. Now, this little organ, it's tiny, but wow, it's vital. It's where our T cells think of them as the immune system's special forces learn who's us and who's them.
Absolutely critical. Yeah. If that goes wrong, you get autoimmune diseases.
Exactly. You need that distinction.
And for, gosh, almost 30 years now, researchers have been trying to make a replacement for kids born with immune problems like DeGeorge syndrome or, you know, adults who lose their thymus function after chemo. But they kept hitting these roadblocks. Three big ones, really. First, the main thymus cells, the TECs. They just died off way too quickly in the lab dish.
Right. They senesce. They get old fast.
Exactly. Or if they tried using stem cells, those derived TECs just wouldn't mature properly. They didn't become fully functional.
And the third?
Artificial scaffolds. They tried building supports, but those only ever offered, like, a temporary fix, not a long-term solution.
Okay. And then the second paper, it's on a completely different scale, right?
Mm-hmm.
Down inside the cell, dealing with ROS.
Reactive oxygen species, yeah, ROS. We usually hear about them as the bad guys, you know, linked to cancer, neurodegeneration.
Damaging molecules.
Yeah. Right. But while they can be damaging, cells also use them as signals, really important ones. The big mystery has been, how do cells actually sense ROS levels? And how do they control how much they make? The second paper, it uncovers this, well, really surprising new pathway. It connects ROS sensing directly to the mitochondria, the cell's power plants. A very neat feedback loop, actually.
Okay, let's unpack that first story then. Engineering a thymus. It sounds like something out of science fiction, really.
Yeah.
Why the big push? What was driving this?
Well, the push was coming from two sides, really. Clinically, it's urgent. You've got kids born with DeGeorge. Their immune systems are severely underdeveloped. Or patients post-chemo, right? They lose that thymic function. Without it, they're incredibly vulnerable. Infections, graft versus host disease after transplants. It's serious.
So a clear medical need.
Definitely. But also a scientific need. Immunologists, they desperately needed a human model. How do things like neoantigens from tumors or these new checkpoint inhibitor drugs for cancer, How do they really affect how T cells get trained?
Mouse models don't quite tell the whole story.
They just don't cut it sometimes. The immune systems are different enough. So the ambition here was huge.
Yeah.
Make a living graft to rebuild immunity and figure out the basic biology, you know, how these key signals actually build the thymus.
Okay, so here's the really critical part then. How did they crack those problems?
Mm.
The cells dying off, not maturing.
Yeah.
How'd they get past that?
Right. This was the first big innovation. They managed to isolate a very specific kind of rare group of stem cells from pediatric thymus tissue, the real builders of the thymus.
Okay.
And the key trick, the breakthrough, was adding a genetic on switch. It let them turn on crucial thymus genes, like one called FOXN1, using a simple antibiotic, doxycycline, as the trigger. Then they grew these cells in a special soup, a conditioned medium. Mm. And this specific recipe, it let them create self-renewing thymic epithelial stem cells, TECHI-ECs.
Self-renewing?
Yeah, they could keep dividing for over 40 passages in the lab, which is a lot. And they stayed stable, kept their thymic identity, no genetic weirdness. That basically solved the problem of keeping the cells alive and functional long-term.
Wow, okay. 40 passages is impressive.
Yeah.
But just having the cells isn't enough, is it? The thymus has that complex structure, the cortex, the medulla. It needs architecture. Yeah. How do they build that without a scaffold?
That's innovation number two, scaffold-free assembly. They didn't use any artificial structure. They just mixed these teskes with other primary cells, endothelial cells for blood vessels, mesenchymal cells for support tissue, in these special little wells where cells don't stick well. And the amazing thing is they just self-organized. They formed these little spheres, organoids, that perfectly mimicked the thymus's internal zones, the cortex and medulla. Wow,
self-assembly.
Yeah. And here's something really cool. These organoids started expressing a protein called AIR. AIR is crucial for teaching T cells tolerance, basically telling them, don't attack the body's own stuff.
Preventing autoimmunity.
Exactly. And they even figured out how it organized. Using time-lapse imaging, they saw a signal, WNT5A, coming from those mesenchymal cells, was essential for getting the medulla part to form correctly. They even proved it using CRISPR gene editing. It shows just how precisely they could engineer this.
That level of control and self-organization is, well, it's pretty stunning.
It really is. It sets this work apart.
And you mentioned this was a big collaboration. Stanford, ETH Zurich, Chan Zuckerberg, Biohub.
Absolutely key. You needed the surgical access to tissue, the stem cell expertise, the bioengineering for the microfluidics, and then the really high-end sequencing to see what was happening at the single cell level. That whole ecosystem made it possible.
Okay, the million-dollar question then. Did these lab-grown thyma actually work? Could they do the job?
Right, the ultimate test. Yeah. That's innovation number three, functional transplantation. They took these mini thymus organoids and implanted them into immunodeficient mice, mice that had been given human cord blood cells so they could essentially build a human immune system.
Okay, and the results?
Pretty phenomenal, honestly. The organoids quickly grew their own blood supply, they vascularized, they survived for over 6 months, and crucially, they started pumping out mature human T cells, both helper T cells and killer T cells.
The main types, yeah.
The main types, yeah. And here's the really important part, the aha moment, maybe. These T cells weren't just generic. They had a diverse repertoire, meaning they could recognize lots of different potential threats, just like in a healthy immune system. And critically, they showed central tolerance. They learned not to attack human self-antigens, no autoreactive clones.
Which was a problem before.
A big problem with some earlier approaches. Compared to previous attempts where things kind of fizzled out after weeks, these organoids produced 10 times more T cells, and they were the right kind of T cells, functional and tolerant. It's a quantum leap, really.
That genuinely sounds like a paradigm shift.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, even groundbreaking studies have next steps, right? Mm-hmm. What are the limitations here? Where do they go next?
You're absolutely right. No study is the final word. So what this study does is, theoretically, it nails down that this FOXN1 WNT signaling pathway is key for human thymus stem cells. It gives us a mechanism. Technologically, it's a blueprint for making these transplantable scaffold-free organoids. That's a huge practical advance.
The applications.
Well, the most obvious is a potential graft for patients without a thymus. But also, think about inducing tolerance for organ transplants, maybe even xenotransplants down the line, or making better T-cell therapies for cancer. This could be a platform for all that.
But the hurdles.
Hurdles remain, for sure. Right now, the best cells come from pediatric donors. Adult thymus isn't as good a source. We don't know about really long-term functions, say, beyond 2 years, or if there's any risk of weird autoimmune issues popping up later. And then there's the big one, scaling up, making these reliably, safely, at clinical-grade GMP standards, and proving they work in larger animals before trying in humans. Those are the next big challenges.
Still, it feels like a massive step forward. A renewable, functioning human thymus.
It really is a truly transformative step, moving away from just temporary fixes.
Okay, let's switch gears completely. From building an organ to this internal cellular stress sensor, ROS. This second paper, it found a new pathway connecting the inside to the outside.
Yeah, it's quite a story. The main takeaway is really counterintuitive. These ROS molecules, often seen as damaging, are actually sensed directly by a protein called VPS35. Now, VPS35 is part of this internal package delivery system in the cell, the retromer complex. And when it senses ROS, it acts like a dimmer switch, basically telling the mitochondria to dial down their protein production, which in turn reduces ROS levels.
A feedback loop.
A very precise one, connecting ROS sensing out in the main part of the cell, the cytosol, to ROS production inside the mitochondria.
That sounds incredibly specific. How on earth did they pinpoint VPS35 and these exact sensing spots? The cell is packed with proteins.
Yeah, they use some really clever techniques. advanced gene editing, base editing, combined with computational screening. This let them systematically test mutations. They found specific spots on the VPS35 protein, particular cysteine residues. And when these cysteines were mutated, the cells acted as if their mitochondria were already inhibited.
Ah, so that was the clue.
That was the big clue, that these specific sites must be involved in sensing ROS. Mutating them made cells either super sensitive or resistant to ROS increase, like finding the exact contact points on the sensor.
Okay, so VPS35 is the direct sensor.
Yeah.
But how does sensing ROS there lead to a change way over in the mitochondria? What's the connection?
Right, the signal relay. So hydrogen peroxide, which is a common ROS, directly oxidizes those specific cysteines on VPS35. It's a chemical modification.
Okay.
And that oxidation has an immediate effect. It makes the whole retromer complex, including VPS35, pop off the internal membranes it usually sits on, these things called endosomes.
It detaches.
It detaches. And that detachment then triggers changes out at the very edge of the cell, the plasma membrane. It causes remodeling there, which sets up the next link in the chain.
So oxidation leads to detachment, which leads to plasma membrane changes.
Mm-hmm.
How does that connect back to the mitochondria? It feels like a long journey across the cell.
It is, but it's direct. The key link is another protein called SLC7A1. This protein needs to be sitting in the right place on the plasma membrane to allow the mitochondria to keep making proteins properly.
Why? What does SLC7A1 do?
It's a transporter. It brings in crucial amino acids like arginine that the mitochondria absolutely need as building blocks for all proteins.
Got it.
So follow the chain. VPS35 gets oxidized by ROS. The retromer complex detaches from endosomes. This messes up the localization of SLC7A1 on the plasma membrane. If SLC7A1 isn't where it should be, arginine transport gets disrupted. The mitochondria don't get their building blocks, so they slow down protein production.
And therefore produce less ROS themselves. It's like the cell hits the brakes on the power factory when things get too stressed.
That's a perfect analogy, exactly, yeah. A self-regulating mechanism.
Okay, this is fascinating biology, but what about the real world? Does this pathway matter for diseases, maybe cancer?
Hugely relevant. This is where it gets very interesting clinically. They showed that if you decrease the amount of VPS35, or if you mimic its oxidation state by mutating those sensor cysteines,
yeah,
it actually makes cancer cells resistant to certain chemotherapies, specifically drugs like cisplatin that work by generating a lot of ROS to kill the cancer cells.
Wow.
They tested this in ovarian cancer models.
Wait, resistant? That seems backward.
It is counterintuitive, but it makes sense with the pathway. If VPS35 is already impaired or acting like it's oxidized, it's already telling the mitochondria to slow down.
Ah, so the chemo drug's ROS effect is blunted because the cell has already put the brakes on.
Precisely. The cancer cell is sort of pre-adapted to the oxidative stress because the sensing pathway is already dampened down. It helps the cancer cell survive the drug.
Yeah.
So this identifies a totally new pathway. Cytosolic ROS talks to the plasma membrane via VPS35, which regulates mitochondrial activity and its ROS output.
Mm.
And this directly impacts chemotherapy resistance. It opens up a whole new angle for potential therapies.
Okay, these are two incredibly rich papers. Just stepping back, what makes them truly innovative and how do they spark ideas for what comes next?
Well, for the Thymus paper, the innovation is just stark. They didn't just make an organoid, they engineered a self-renewing, scaffold-free, transplantable human thymus, one that reliably makes diverse, tolerant T cells.
Mm-hmm.
It's moving way beyond temporary fixes to something truly functional and architecturally correct. It's a blueprint, really.
And future directions there.
Oh, huge. It gives us an unprecedented tool to study human T cell development in vivo, in a human context, understanding tolerance, repertoire shaping, therapeutically, yes, for thymus defects, but also potentially for inducing tolerance for transplants, maybe even across species one day, and for turbocharging cancer immunotherapy by making better engineered T cells. Plus, it really nails down the basic mechanics, that FOXN1 WNT link.
And the ROS paper, the innovation.
Revealing a completely new way cells handle oxidative stress, identifying VPS35 cysteines as the sensors, linking that through retromer and SLC7A1 all the way to mitochondrial output. It's a whole new circuit nobody knew about.
And the inspiration from that.
New drug targets, definitely.
Yeah.
Especially for cancer. Can we manipulate this pathway? Can we resensitize resistant tumors to chemo by targeting VPS35 or SLC7A1, or find other ways to exploit it? It also just fundamentally changes how we think about communication inside the cell. The plasma membrane talking to the mitochondria about stress. That's unexpected. It challenges old assumptions about how cells manage energy and stress.
Both studies really hammer home how interconnected everything is in biology, from whole organs down to these tiny molecular switches. Understanding the fundamentals really seems to be the key to unlocking new therapies.
Well, that was an amazing deep dive, uncovering some truly cutting-edge science today, reshaping how we think about immunity and just basic cellular health. Yeah, we covered the incredible success in engineering that functional, self-renewing thymus, real hope for immune problems there. And then that totally unexpected discovery, how a protein senses ROS, stress out near the edge of the cell to control the mitochondria deep inside. Big implications for cancer resistance.
So here's something to chew on. If scientists can now build a self-sustaining immune organ outside the body and find these fundamental dimmer switches for cell energy based on stress, what other really tough biological problems might be next? How could understanding these circuits maybe change how we approach aging or lead to completely new kinds of personalized medicine for complex diseases? Lots to think about. Keep learning, keep questioning, and join us next time for another deep dive.